Hello, I'm Patrick Leaudet. I'm working on the modeling of marine ecosystem and fish population dynamics for more than 20 years now, and I'm very pleased to contribute to this Argo BGC workshop, since this new technological development represents a critical progress in the monitoring of two key ecosystem variables that I'm using in this modeling work. As introductory remarks, I would like to say that if most international other management organizations have integrated an ecosystem-based approach in their objective, there are still few examples of such an integration. In most cases, the management of exported species is still based on single stock assessment studies, ignoring the environmental and climate variability. We know, at least since the end of the 18th century, the importance of the environment and the recruitment of fish. And to illustrate this purpose, I highlight the work by two famous scientists, Johan Hjort, who is one of the fathers of the ICES, the International Committee for the Exploration of the Sea, created in 1902, and David Cushing, who is quite famous for the work he done on the zooplankton and fish recruitment mechanisms, and who propose a famous match-mismatch hypothesis to explain this variability. So, if understanding the fish recruitment process is so important to eventually forecast the trajectory of adult fish population, why are we still looking for this fisheries scientist holy grail after more than one century? In the following presentation, I will try to give some elements of response to this question, and I will use the match-mismatch concept of David Cushing as a common red thread for this presentation. The first big issue for marine fisheries scientists is observation. It is extremely difficult to observe large-scale events of spawning together with environmental biophysical conditions. That's probably one of the reasons why the attractive Cushing hypothesis lack a strong demonstration and applications. One of the most convincing studies supporting these mechanisms is probably by Beaugrand et al. In this study, they were able to exploit a very large database of zooplankton observation from the continuous plankton recorder, and derived index of abundance and quality of zooplankton that correlate pretty well with the time series of abundance of recruitment in the cod for the North Atlantic. This nice correlation was obtained based on a huge effort of observation. Almost 50 years of zooplankton monitoring with the CPR, representing a huge work at sea, but also in labs to count and identify the zooplankton species. And the fishing database, which is used, is also quite exceptional as it concerns one of the most fished and studied species in the North Atlantic. But despite this effort, we are still far here from an analysis of co-located observation. Another example here that I like to use concerns tropical tuna and fisheries. This slide illustrates the importance of primary production for the survival of tuna larvae and then the subsequent recruitment. During the powerful 1997-98 El Niño, one unusual large intense bloom of phytoplankton was observed at the peak of this event. This is the yellow spot that you observe along the equator on this image. And a few months later, it was followed by a very large increase of juvenile tuna in the catch of the percent fisheries in the same region. This is shown by the presence of small fish in the size frequency samples. The delay between the phytoplankton bloom and the catch of juveniles match well with the time needed for larvae to reach this range of size. Therefore, the peak of recruitment was likely associated to very favorable conditions for the survival of tuna larvae and juveniles with warm waters and high concentration of food, that is the zooplankton, which developed quickly after the phytoplankton. So can we assume that the surface chlorophyll data provide a good proxy to test the Cushing match mismatch mechanisms at large scale? The answer needs to differentiate between different systems, cold and warm ecosystem. For the warm ecosystem, zooplankton develop almost immediately after the phytoplankton. So there is a very good match between the variability of phytoplankton and zooplankton. But in cold ecosystem, there is a delay between the peak of phytoplankton bloom and then the development of zooplankton. And this delay increases with decreasing temperature of the water. For the vertical dimension, here also we have different situations. In temperate cold system, the production is mostly in the surface layer. So this is shown on this transect on the bottom of the slide with the red spot corresponding to the region of New Zealand. So it's a transect from New Zealand to Tahiti. And you can see then that the green pattern is deepening along the transect when moving to the tropical system. That's what we call the deep maximum chlorophyll. And in that case, there is clearly a mismatch between this deep chlorophyll maximum in the tropical system with the surface chlorophyll. However, with the use of more and more vertical profiles, especially those of the Argo floats, it becomes easier to estimate depth of the deep chlorophyll maximum and thus to integrate primary production vertically. Thus, if we replace surface chlorophyll by vertically integrated primary production, we can solve the mismatch due to the vertical dimension. Note that this problem is not fully solved yet. There are still inconsistencies in the different solutions proposed to vertically integrate primary production, as illustrated by these three different products and the existence of many others. But there is still good hope to converge toward an optimal solution with the increasing number of profiles. Now we still have one issue regarding the mismatch in synchronicity for the temperate and cold system. It seems impossible to propose a synoptic approach to observe and monitor zooplankton as the ocean color for phytoplankton. Thus, we have to rely on modeling. And I've been working with my colleagues on one modeling approach with the objective of keeping inputs and outputs as close as possible from observation that are satellite-derived primary production and temperature and currents from ocean circulation models at high resolution and using massive data assimilation from satellite and in-situ observation. One good example to get this such product is the European Copernicus program. And the resulting zooplankton from the model is now becoming also a product of this Copernicus catalog. Of course, we need more validation, but it seems that we are not too far to solve this synchronicity mismatch, and not only at large scale, but also at mesoscale thanks to the high resolution and data assimilation for the physical components. Alas, we may have to deal with more match mismatch. Assuming that environmental conditions in temperature and zooplankton can be correctly defined and used to produce a potential spawning habitat for a given species, there are several other match mismatch mechanisms to consider to effectively compute the realized habitat, the one that can be used to predict a useful recruitment indicator. These other match mismatch include the presence of adult fish, presence or absence of adult fish, the spawners, and this presence may depend on other factors, particularly the concentration in dissolved oxygen in subsurface, or the presence of prey of adults, so the Micronectin species. And the match mismatch with predators of eggs and larvae, which is the opposite of the Cushing match mismatch with zooplankton. And here the predators of larvae are again Micronectin. The concentration of dissolved oxygen in the ocean is still poorly observed at the scale of the global ocean. The most used data set is likely the World Ocean Atlas that compiles all available profiles of oxygen. However, as you can see on this map, a very large portion of the global ocean is drastically undersampled. And thus, only average monthly interpolated 3D fields can be produced from this database. And even if the variability for this essential variable is largely controlled by physical criteria, we need to rapidly increase our capacity to monitor the change of this variable, especially now with the big issue of climate change and ocean warming. Then we have the Micronectin, that is the mid-trophic level of the ocean food web. Micronectin organisms are a mix of small species in a range of a few centimeters that are the forage of most larger marine species, fish, mammals, or seabirds. Here you have nice examples showing the feeding behavior of two large predators. The elephant seal, which is a nice species for scientists, since it can bring with him a lot of various sensors. In this study, there were not only temperature, salinity, and fluorescence sensors, but also accelerometers, allowing to identify each tentative of catching a prey. This is represented by all these black dots. So clearly, this species spends most of its time to dive and chase prey below 200 meter depths. This is what is known as the mesopelagic ocean. For the example of tuna, we have less detail, but the pattern is also similar, at least during the day. Unfortunately, we have few information and knowledge on the mesopelagic species, and despite they represent the largest biomass on Earth. As for zooplankton, I've been working for long with my colleagues on the modeling of this foraging species. Today we can propose a model representing six groups of epipelagic and mesopelagic Micronectin, defined according to their vertical migration behavior and macroecological relationships, linking time of development to water temperature. Vertically integrated primary production is the source of energy, and ocean temperature drive the temporal dynamics, while oceanic currents control the spatial dynamics. Recently, we have been able to propose simulation outputs for this group through the European Copernicus CMEMS program. The simulation covered the satellite era with ocean color data since 1998 at a resolution of a quarter degree per week. This month, we will release an upgrade of this product at a higher resolution of 112 degree per day. These zooplankton and Micronectin model outputs have been already used with animal tracking data and suggest that there is an interest to to use them rather than ocean color directly to study their habitat and feeding ecology. It is also possible to integrate the spawning and feeding habitat built on these different variables in a world spatial fish population model structured by age as a standard stock assessment model, adding growth, mortality, and local recruitment, that time based on spawning index and adult biomass, and without forgetting, of course, all the fisheries and associated fishing mortality. As in standard stock assessment models, fishing data and eventually tagging data, when they are available, are used to estimate the model parameters. You can get more detail for this model and its application in a series of published papers and also a dedicated website. One illustration of the result from this model is shown on this animation. The background color is the predicted density of skipjack, and the black circles are proportional to the observed catch by the person fishery. The resolution is quarter degree per week and monthly for the catch. The animation shows the development of El Niño event with the extension of the habitat of skipjack to the Central Pacific and the movement of the person fleet following this displacement. A regional real-time version of this model has been implemented for the Indonesian government within the project INDESO with a higher resolution at 112 degrees per day. Note that the regional model needs to obtain open boundaries condition from the global model since fish can exit or enter the regional domain. In conclusion, the third dimension, the depth, remains the weakness in monitoring ocean primary pollution and dissolved oxygen, and Argo BGC float should bring more information and data on these two essential variables. An improved vertically integrated primary pollution means also more realistic models of zooplankton and macroplankton, two other essential ecosystem variables for fisheries, oceanography, and marine management studies. These improved essential variables open the door to models in the habitat or spatial dynamics, offering new management tools, additional features for spatial management and forecasting skills, and allowing to discriminate impacts of fishing from those due to natural variability or climate change. Thank you for your attention.